Okay guys, so I'm here to bore you for the next 15 minutes, please bear with me. My name is Cyrus, I've been working with Linux and programming for over a decade now. I'm a senior tech lead at InMobi, and this is usually how I code, or not. So why are we here? I mean, most of you guys here are either belong to operations or dev or DevOps or engineering, or either have some way or the other to do with production infrastructure. So you got everything settled down. You have your best monitoring systems, best monitoring scripts, cron jobs. You have bought a lot of incident management systems. You have a NOC looking after everything. But when it rains, it pours. When things go bad so ugly that either you think of quitting your job or you just shut down the damn product. Why? Because we have noise. We have noise in our monitoring systems. Imagine a service going down. It will have repercussions. The node alarms will come in. The memory checks will fail. Anything depending with that service would fail. So you'll have like a hundred or few odd alarms for that particular subsystems, and then something which hooks onto it as well. And beneath all that would be your actual alarms of other subsystems. And if that's not enough, you'll always have that one guy who forgot to put your monitoring system on maintenance mode. That kind of sucks, yeah. So what leads to this problem? As your company grows, your infrastructure grows. With growing infrastructure, you need to fine-tune your monitoring system. You need to fine-tune how your alerts go in, what the thresholds are. You need to make sure that your team follows a good discipline as to when your notifications should be disabled, when they have to re-enabled again, and nothing of it should be manual. I mean, you should make sure that it's all automated, it's seamless, and that does not affect how you scale. But unfortunately, you know, we have your Dockers, your LXCs, your C groups, you've got your whatnot. We still use Nagios. Nagios was made by one guy a gazillion years ago. We probably still use cron jobs to check if disk status fails or my DB connection is down. And we continue to do that, even as a scale. There are things that help you. There are a lot of things that help you, actually. But most of them are as covered. A monitoring system, or a small sort of an event actioner on the monitoring system. Let's say you have CloudWatch, right? CloudWatch says, okay, if your alert fails, you invoke SNS with this. Your monitor says, if my service goes down, do this with it. But we are stuck with the way that application is coded, or we have to just live with that application. CloudWatch, you have to live with CloudWatch, you have to pay for every alert. OpsGenie PagerDuty is good for notifying or waking up you guys at the middle of the night. Other than that, you usually don't go to the dashboards of PagerDuty and see what my system health status is. And then, obviously, you just call the NOC guy and say to restart the server. So what can really help? Imagine a system that allows you to define an event, take an action against that event. While doing so, you can send all your, you can hook up all your monitoring systems, say fire your alerts to this event, and you can have the system invoke scripts or pray to God or whatever you want via plugins. If you have that with the utmost simplicity, then you can keep using your Nagios, your CloudWatch, your cron jobs, and you don't need to actually, you know, have a dedicated, awesome monitoring system which can do it for you. You can just use whatever you are using, plug it in with the system, and invoke your scripts. I have that for you. It's called the CitoEngine. A very brief overview. The engine works extremely, extremely simple. It has an event listener. Listens to REST-based API calls. The events go to a queue. There's a polar which consumes the queue. There's an engine which takes decisive action based on the settings configured for that event, and it calls up the plugin which is corresponding to that event. It's as simple as that. If you look closely, it just makes sense, right? You have an alert, you want something to do with it only and only if you have a certain condition met. And then you can invoke whatever you want. You can invoke PagerDuty and wake some guy up, you run a script and restart your service, you create a Jira ticket, call up Amazon and scale your system, scale down your system, attach an EBS. How it works. You define an event, and event definition is basically, if you guys are aware with Nagios, it's similar to service definition, where you say, okay, let me just define an event which has, this says, my disk is at 75%, let me give it a severity, assign it to a team, and put it in a category. Keep it enabled, and let me do something against it. What is this against it part? We would invoke an action. Out here, I have a sample event action which says, invoke the TempForge plugin on the plugin server Fry if the threshold of that event is twice in 60 seconds. These are the parameters which I want you to send to the plugin. It's pretty basic. And what is a plugin? So plugin is an extension to CitoEngine where you simply hook up your scripts and you let it listen on a RESTful API. It's extremely simple as that. Let's say you have a Jira, API script. You say, if I receive a call on Jira hook, you know, create a Jira ticket for me. The plugin server also allows you to bind each plugin to access keys. So you know who can invoke what plugin, and you know, you don't want accidental restarts of service. And this all fits in by So this is how your plugin is defined in the system. The server is attached in CitoEngine. Your active plugins show up. When an incident comes in, so this is your alert. This is the final thing which comes in. When an incident comes in on an event, you have your host name attached to it. It'll say there are 5 occurrences of this incident. The event actions that took place were I logged to this, so these are the sample ones. I invoked this plugin and I invoked the TempForge plugin, and there were no return codes. So everything worked hunky dory, no issues at all. You can acknowledge the event, so it will stop taking actions against it, and it will silently just append it as and when required. If you close it, any new incident coming in would create a new action item again, workflow again. How do I send events? 3 simple members, JSON members call. The event ID, the message, and the element. Element could be a host name, it could be a message, it could be just about anything that identifies a unique key pair combination of the event and the incident with the event and the element name. We give you dashboards. Your dashboard, this is a generic dashboard, by the way. It shows you how many active events are there, how many acknowledged, how many got cleared in the last 24 hours. You can view the incident details as I showed you in the previous screen, or you can hack it right over on the screen itself. I also offer you team-based dashboards. Remember how I defined a team earlier? So you can have these team-based dashboards showing up in one of your monitors up on the corner. You can continuously keep looking at them and kind of judge, you know, what's going on where. It shows you active against versus acknowledged incidents. But then your boss says, I want reports. We have reports. We got tons of reports. One of them, you even got CSV reports for all that's concerned. We got ones which are of how many common incidents got fired, which event got fired the most. Sorry, the resolution is a bit off. Which team has how many events, and so on. So who would need it? Preferably anyone who wants to manage a production or a development infrastructure, for what it's worth. If you want an infrastructure to be monitored, then you want those monitorings to come up, hook up to a decent centralized place so you can take actions against those incidents. It could be a NOC. Could be PE teams, it could be your QA team who can just have and hook up their Jenkins calls to this and maybe take actions against it. So the possibilities are literally endless. This is made using primarily Python. I'm still testing out RabbitMQ and Maria PGSQL. Should be out in couple of weeks, I'd say. And it's completely open source, Apache 2. Welcome you guys to download it, use it, and it's live. That was a crisp talk. Any questions? I'm still testing it out. So Actually, I released the code last night, last minute coding. So by the way, this is something which I've been working out of in my personal hours and weekends, so hence the delay. I know in the funnel I had promised on April 1st, Shrikant then threw a shoe at me and they said, April 1st is gone, he fooled me. But yeah, it's out. We need guys to work on it. Yes, Gaurav. Django. Yeah, Django. Yeah, go ahead.
So the plugins, how exactly you write it in a shell script or write it as a Python file and then you...
Good point. So there is no limitation to what you can do. If it's an executable binary, it's a plugin.
So it has a DSL?
Sorry?
It has a...
No, absolutely not. You can use... So you can use TempWatch. Your user bin TempWatch, right? You can add that as a plugin.
No. Anything I mean to say the to new plugin which I write... Mm-hmm. What sort of a DSL it
does takes? Not require any DSL. All you have to do is take your executable, dump it in a directory, and link it here. You just say that my executable is here. It takes these parameters. That's it. I don't want a DSL. I'm not telling you how to write your plugins. You can write as and how you want.
Oh.
All you need to do
is
when you call this plugin,
okay. You
need to know the parameters that you're going to pass to this plugin. Okay. So let's say if you're calling, you have uname, and the parameter you're going to pass is A, right?
Okay.
So when you invoke the action, you say pass the parameter called -a to this plugin.
Okay. Yes, so it uses command.py for doing the command line execution?
No. It uses subprocess.
Okay. Thanks.
So can you go back to the slide where you are showing the JSON?
The JSON, all right.
So I want to understand, typically an event requires you to monitor some things.
Mm-hmm.
And in the JSON that you are showing, you mm-hmm. have the concept of an element,
right.
Which you would, that is probably, how is that enough to generate an event? And just take an example
mm-hmm.
that you mentioned that, let's say, your disk is an element.
Right.
And you want to generate an event when 70% of your disk is
right.
full. How do you define this?
So whom do you generate this alert against? You generate it against a host. The disk belongs to a host. Your host is the element.
Okay.
In the engine, you have a unique event ID defined, like event ID 6 over here. So event ID 6 stands for any disk alarm. Then you need to attach something else to it to say that now this is a unique key, that something else is the host name here. You could, for your, what it's worth, you could say slash dev, whatever, XDA1 is full. You can attach that as an element. It does not stop you from creating any correlation with the event ID itself. The idea
so
is
what
that
I'm trying to connect is,
uh-huh.
so you have the concept of this event, which is, let's say, is enough to define mm-hmm. what is an event. But then there is a concept of, I think what you're calling it as a plugin, which
right.
has the intelligence of generating that event. How are you tying these two things together?
Oh, sorry. So the concept is slightly off. The plugin is the final action you take against an incident coming in. The definition of what you're going to do when something happens is in the event action. So plugin is the final thing which you call with a bunch of parameters when an event reaches a specific threshold. Your disk of getting full is an event, right? Sorry, it's an incident. You hook it up with this event. Now the engine then says, okay, I got event ID 6 with this disk alert. It has now come to me twice in 60 seconds. Go ahead and invoke this plugin.
Right. So I think my question now is, how do you define the incident as part of your system? How do I define that?
You just defined an event. So, the incident is something which inherits the event. The event is a definition. Event is a definition of what an alert. It's an alert definition, your service definition you have in Nagios, and then you have your groups coming in. So you throw incident. The incident is actually similar to what an alert is. I call it an incident because it's very much the ITIL thingy.
Thank you.
Cheers.
Hello?
Yes.
Yeah. So what is the most complex rule that you can put to take an action?
Good question. Very, very, very good question. So we, at this point of time, is just X events in Y seconds.
Okay.
But we are rigorously trying to come up with more complicated if this then that kind of rules.
Okay.
Which will come in.
And one major thing, how does this scale?
Scales horizontally. So the components which I showed you in the architectural slide are all horizontally scalable.
Mm-hmm.
There's no.
How does your rule scale, the rules processor that you have that actually does this analysis? As you get to more complicated rules and matches, what would be the processing model that you propose for your
I haven't reached there yet. As I said, you know, my rules engine is extremely simple right now.
Okay.
I'm going to expand against it.
Okay.
But the code is modularized enough that I can compartmentalize the decision-making engine, put it over in a different thread, put it over in a different box, send an incident for decision
makes
to
sense,
a separate
right.
grid. So it's possibilities are endless, I'll say, but that's a good question.
Yeah.
Yes.
This runs as an agent on all the boxes or?
No agents at all. No agents at all.
So can you go back to the plugins?
Okay. This guy?
Yeah. Here you mentioned that one of the plugin is restart Tomcat.
Uh-huh.
So how would that happen?
Exactly. So how would you inform your Nog guys to restart a server? Either you have a jump box or you tell them to log into a box and restart it. The plugin server sits in, let's say, your particular division's subnet, and you write your script or invoke the binary which can do it remotely for you. The idea behind this is to keep the plugin server isolated enough such that every department can have their own plugin server for what it's concerned, so have isolations like that. And further down that, you have your API keys linked with the plugin. So let's say you are only allowed to run the restart Tomcat plugin, then I'll give you a key which can only invoke this plugin. And you just take that key, put it in the engine once, and have all your incidents fire against it.
I think we're just running short of time.
Awesome.
So, it's a very interesting question I would like to take, otherwise do a one-on-one.
Oh, you have a question, Srikant?
I think there's one there.
Hi. Hi.
Hi.
So can we push data from Nagios or Zensu to...
Perfect. Yes, absolutely. So by default, I'll give you a very simple scenario how to hook up Nagios. If Nagios allows you custom variables, in your definition, you just say underscore event ID X, and we have plugin hooks to Nagios, which are released. You can just invoke that command when you fire when you define a service. The basic example is the default command which gets called up is notify by email, which sends you Nagios notification. So there'll be another command. Just an executable, which gets invoked whenever Nagios wants to throw an alert. And that alert will go to the system.
So it can be integrated with any monitoring system like CloudWatch?
Exactly. That is the point. Yeah. Okay. CloudWatch, Zensu, Zenos, you name it, even your cron jobs. You can integrate anything inbound and anything outbound. You have absolutely no limitations at all.
Okay.
That's why it's so simple. That's why it does not have a complicated if this then that modularization. Because right now, what I need at this moment is if I have X number of alerts, at least do this action. And yes, as and when you know we get good feedback, we get good logic around it, we can start making things complicated. Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Uh huh.
Yes.
So how would that work? Each event would hold its own. Each rule would hold its own state.
Yes.
And as the events and the number of rules get more complicated,
things would get complicated. That's true. But I have not designed the system yet. I have yet to design that system. Maybe you could put in a Git issue and then we could discuss it on GitHub. Awesome.
Round of applause for Cyrus.
Thank you, guys. Thank you for listening.
And it's available in GitHub starting yesterday. Okay. Awesome. Thanks, Cyrus.